inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. And whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. John Donne caught it years ago and placed it in graphic terms. No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. And then he goes on toward the end to say, any man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind. Therefore, never sin to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee.
Intense and merciless.
And I oppose the war in Vietnam because I love America. I speak out against it not in anger but with anxiety and sorrow in my heart, and above all with a passionate desire to see our beloved country stand as the moral example of the world. I speak out against this war because I am disappointed with America. There can be no great disappointment where there is no great love.
For those who say to me, stick to civil rights, I have another answer. That is that I've fought too long and too hard now against segregated public accommodations to end up segregating my moral concern. I'm not going to do that. But others can do what they want to do. That's their business. Other civil rights leaders, for various reasons, refuse or can't take a stand or have to go along with the administration. That's their business. But I must say tonight that I know that justice is indivisible. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere.
My expertise, as you know, is CIA, Marine Corps, three CIA secret wars. I had a position in the National Security Council in 1975 as the chief of the Angola task force running the secret war in Angola. It was the third CIA secret war I was part of. The national security law creating the National Security Council and the CIA, as you know, was passed in 1947. The CIA was given this charter to perform such other duties and function as might be necessary to the national security interests, and given a vague authority to protect its sources and methods. I think it was in the mid-80s that I coined this phrase, the Third World War, because in my research I realized that we were not attacking the Soviet Union and the CIA's activities. We were attacking people in the Third World. And I'm going to just quickly, in the interest of time, just give you a little sense of what that means, this Third World War. Basically, it's the third, I believe, in terms of loss of life and human destruction, the third bloodiest war in all of history. They undertake to run operations in every corner of the globe. They also undertook the license of operating just totally above and beyond U.S. laws. They had a license, if you will, to kill, but also they took that to a license to smuggle drugs, a license to do all kinds of things to other people in other societies in violation of international law, our law, and every principle of nations working together for a healthier and more peaceful world. Meanwhile, again, they battle to convert the U.S. legal system in such a way that it would give them control of our society. Now, we have massive documentation of what they call the secret wars of the CIA. We don't have to guess or speculate. We had the Church Committee investigate them in 1975, gave us our first really in-depth, powerful look inside this structure. Senator Church said in the 14 years before he did his investigation that he found they had run 900 major operations and 3,000 minor operations. And if you extrapolate that over the whole period of the 40-odd years that we've had a CIA, you come up with 3,000 major operations and over 10,000 minor operations. Every one of them illegal, every one of them disruptive of the lives and societies of other peoples, and many of them bloody and gory beyond comprehension almost. Extensively, we manipulated and organized the overthrow of functioning constitutional democracies in other countries. We organized secret armies and directed them to fight in just about every continent in the world. We encouraged ethnic minorities to rise up and fight. People like the Mosquito Indians in Nicaragua, the Kurds in the Middle East, the Hmongs in Southeast Asia. And of course, we have organized and we still do and fund death squads in countries around the world, like the Treasury Police in El Salvador, which are responsible for most of the killing of the 50,000 people just in the 80s, and there were 70,000 before that. An orchestration, CIA secret teams, and propaganda led us directly into the Korean War. We were attacking China from the islands, Kaimoi, Matsu, Thailand, Tibet. A lot of drug trafficking involved in this, by the way, until eventually we convinced ourselves to fight the Chinese in Korea. We had the Korean War, and 1 million people were killed. Same thing for the Vietnam War, and we have extensive documentation of how the CIA was involved at every level, or the national security complex, because it's a very cooperative thing, into manipulating the nation into the Vietnam War. And we wound up creating the Golden Triangle, in which the CIA, Air America airplanes, were flying in arms to our allies and flying back out with the heroin. We launched the largest, this is something that Jimmy Carter did, Admiral Turner brags about it, the operation in Afghanistan. Biggest single operation, I'm told, in the history of the CIA's secret wars. And sure enough, very quickly we produced the Golden Crescent, which is still the largest source of heroin perhaps in the world today. Trying to summarize this third world war that the CIA, the U.S. National Security Complex, with the military all interwoven in it in many different ways, has been waging. Let me just put it this way. The best heads that I coordinate with studying this thing, we count at least minimum figure 6 million people who've been killed in this long 40-year war that we've waged against the people of the Third World. These are not Soviets. We have not been parachuting teams into the Soviet Union to kill and hurt and maim people, especially not since 1954, when they developed actually a capability of dropping atomic weapons on the United States. They aren't British, French, Swedes, Swiss, Belgians. We don't do bloody, gory operations in the countries of Europe. These are all people of the Third World. They're people of countries like the Congo, Vietnam, Kampuchea, Indonesia, Nicaragua, where conspicuously they nor their governments do not have the capability of doing any physical hurt to the United States. They don't have ICBMs. They don't have armies or navies. They could not hurt us if they wanted to. There has rarely been any evidence that they really wanted to. And that, in fact, is perhaps the whole point. If they had had ICBMs, we probably wouldn't have done the things to them for fear of retaliation. Cheap shots, if you will, killing people of other countries of the world who cannot defend themselves under the guise of secrecy and under the rubric of national security.
Network of official functionaries, spies, mercenaries, ex-generals, profiteers, and super patriots who for a variety of motives operate outside the legitimate institutions of government. Presidents have turned to them when they can't win the support of the Congress or the people, creating that unsupervised power so feared by the framers of our Constitution. Just imagine that William Casey's dream came true. Suppose the enterprise grew into a super secret, self-financing, self-perpetuating organization. Suppose they decided on their own to assassinate Gorbachev or the leader of white South Africa. Could a president control them? And what if he became the enterprise's public enemy number one? Who would know? Who would say no?
The secret government will continue in a few moments.
with the history of our secret government. World War II was over. Europe lay devastated. The United States emerged as the most powerful nation on Earth. But from the rubble rose a strange new world, a peace that was not peace, and a war that was not war. We saw it emerging when the Soviets occupied Eastern Europe. The Cold War had begun.
An iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe.
The Russians had been our ally against the Nazis, an expedient alliance for the sake of war. Now they were our enemy. To fight them, we turned to some of the very men who had inflicted on humanity the horrors of Hitler's madness. We hired Nazis as American spies. We struck a secret bargain with the devil.
One that I know real well is Klaus Barbie. He was wanted by the French as their number one war criminal. And somehow we employed a man like that as a very secretive informant.
Erhard Fabringhaus was employed in the U.S. Army Counterintelligence Corps and assigned to work with Nazi informants spying on the Russians. One of them was Klaus Barbie, the Butcher of Lyon, who had tortured and murdered thousands of Jews and resistance fighters. The Americans did not turn Barbie over to the French when they finished with him. They helped him escape to Bolivia. Other top Nazis were smuggled into the United States to cooperate in the war against the new enemy. So began the morality of the Cold War. Anything goes. The struggle required a mentality of permanent war, a perpetual state of emergency. And it meant a vast new apparatus of power that radically transformed our government. Its foundations were laid when President Truman signed into law the National Security Act of 1947.
Now, that National Security Act of 1947 changed dramatically the direction of this great nation. It established the framework for a national security state.
Admiral Jean LaRocque rose through the ranks from ensign to become a strategic planner for the Pentagon and now headed the Center for Defense Information, a public interest group.
The National Security Act of 47 gave us the National Security Council. Never have we had a National Security Council so concerned about the nation's security that we were always looking for threats and looking how to orchestrate our society to oppose those threats. National security was invented, almost, in 1947. And now it has become the prime mover of everything we do is measured against something we invented in 1947. The National Security Act also gave us the Central Intelligence Agency.
This is the house the Cold War built, the CIA, the core of the new secret government. Its chief legitimate duty was to gather foreign intelligence for America's new role as a world power. Soon it was taking on covert operations, abroad and at home. As its mission expanded, the CIA recruited adventuresome young men like Notre Dame's All-American, Ralph McGehee.
I look back to the individual that I was when I joined the agency. I was a dedicated cold warrior who felt the agency was out there fighting for liberty, justice, democracy, and religion around the world. And I believe wholeheartedly in this. I just felt proud every day that I worked because I was out at the vanguard of the battle against the international evil empire, international communist, the evil empire.
Iran, 1953. The CIA mounted its first major covert operation to overthrow a foreign government. The target was the Prime Minister of Iran, Mohammad Mossadegh. He held power legitimately through his country's parliamentary process, and he was popular. Washington had once looked to him as the man to prevent a communist takeover. But that was before Mossadegh decided that the Iranian state, not British companies, ought to own and control the oil within Iran's own borders. When he nationalized the British-run oil fields, Washington saw red. The Secretary of State, John Foster Dulles, and his brother Alan, director of the CIA, decided with Eisenhower's approval to overthrow Mossadegh and reinstate the Shah of Iran. The mobs paid by the CIA and the police and soldiers bribed by the CIA drove Mossadegh from office.
Crown Prince Abdullah greets the Shah as he lands at Baghdad Airport after a seven-hour flight from Rome.
The King of Kings was back in control and more pliable than Mossadegh. American oil companies took over almost half of Iran's production. U.S. arms merchants moved in with $18 billion of weapon sales over the next 20 years. But there were losers.
Nearly everybody in Iran of any importance has had a brother or a mother or a sister or a son or a father tortured, jailed, deprived of property without due process. I mean, an absolutely buccaneering dictatorship in our name that we supported. SAVAK was created by the CIA.
SAVAK, the Shah's secret police, tortured and murdered thousands of his opponents. General Richard Secord and Albert Hakim, whom we met earlier, were among those who helped supply the Shah's insatiable appetite for the technology of control. But the weapons and flattery heaped by America on the Shah blinded us to the growing opposition of his own people. They rose up in 1979 against him. Death to the Shah, they shouted. Death to the American Satan.
Khomeini is a direct consequence, and the hostage crisis is a direct consequence, and the resurgence of the Shia is a direct consequence of the CIA's overthrow of Mossadegh in 1953.
Guatemala, 1954. Flushed with success, America's secret government decided another troublesome leader must go. This time it was Jacobo Arbenz, the democratically elected president of Guatemala. Philip Redinger was recruited from the Marines to join the CIA team.
It was explained to me that this was very important for the security of the United States, that we were going to prevent a Soviet beachhead in this hemisphere, which we have heard about very recently, of course, and that the Guatemalan government was communist, and we had to do something about it.
President Arbenz had admired Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and his government voted often with the American position at the United Nations. But in trying to bring a new deal to Guatemala, Arbenz committed two sins in the eyes of the Eisenhower administration. First, when he opened the system to all political parties, he recognized the communists, too.
Well, of course, there was no even a hint of communism in his government. He had no communists in his cabinet. He did permit the existence of a very small communist party.
Arbenz also embarked on a massive land reform program. Less than 3% of the landowners held more than 70% of the land. So Arbenz nationalized more than 1.5 million acres, including land owned by his own family, and turned it over to peasants. Much of that land belonged to the United Fruit Company, the giant American firm that was intent on keeping Guatemala, quite literally, a banana republic. United Fruit appealed to its close friends in Washington, including the Dulles brothers, who said that Arbenz was openly playing the communist game. He had to go.
It was sudden death for him. I mean, there was no chance of him winning this fight because of the fact that he had done this to the United Fruit Company, plus the fact that he was overthrowing the hegemony of the United States over this area. And this was dangerous. It could not be tolerated. We couldn't tolerate this.
From Honduras, the same country that today is the Contra staging base, the CIA launched a small band of mercenaries against Guatemala. They were easily turned back. So with its own planes and pilots, the CIA then bombed the capital. Arbenz fled and was immediately replaced by an American puppet, Colonel Carlos Castillo Armas.
He overturned all of the reformist activity of President Arbenz. He gave the land back to the United Fruit Company that had been confiscated. He took land from the peasants and gave it back to the landowners.
The CIA had called its covert action against Guatemala Operation Success. Military dictators ruled the country for the next 30 years. The United States provided them with weapons and trained their officers. The communists we saved them from would have been hard-pressed to do it better. Peasants were slaughtered. Political opponents were tortured. Suspected insurgents were shot, stabbed, burned alive, or strangled. There were so many deaths at one point that coroners complained they couldn't keep up with the workload. Operation Success.
What we did has caused a succession of repressive military dictatorships in that country and has been responsible for the death of over 100,000 of their citizens.
Success breeds success, sometimes with dreary repetition. Mario Sandoval Alarcon began his career in the CIA's adventure in Guatemala. Today, he's known as a godfather of the death squads. In 1981, after lobbying Ronald Reagan's advisors for military aid to Guatemala, Sandoval Alarcon danced at the inaugural ball. Richard Bissell, another veteran of the Guatemalan coup, went on to become the CIA's chief of covert operations. I looked him up several years ago for a CBS documentary. Cuba, 1961. 7 years after Operation Success in Guatemala, Bissell was planning another CIA covert operation.
The assault has begun on the dictatorship of Fidel Castro.
On April 17, 1961, Cuban exiles trained by the CIA at a base in friendly Guatemala landed on the southern coast of Cuba at the Bay of Pigs. The U.S. had promised air support, but President Kennedy canceled it. The invaders, left defenseless, surrendered. 7 months after the disastrous invasion, Kennedy delivered a major foreign policy address.
We cannot, as a free nation, compete with our adversaries in tactics of terror, assassination, false promises, counterfeit mobs, and crises.
The president was not telling the truth. Even as he spoke, his administration was planning a new covert war on Cuba. It would include some of the dirty tricks the president said we were above. The secret government was prepared for anything.
At one time, the CIA organized a small department known as Executive Action, which was a permanent assassination capability.
Well, it wasn't just an assassination capability. It was a capability to discredit or get rid of people. But it could have included assassination.
And it did. There were at least 8 documented attempts to kill Castro. He says there were 2 dozen. And there was even one effort to put LSD in his cigars. To help us get rid of the Cuban leader, our secret government turned to the mafia, just as we once made use of Nazis. The gangsters included the Las Vegas mafioso John Rosselli, the Don of Chicago, Sam Giancana, and the boss of Tampa, Santo Traficante.
If I read you correctly, you're saying it's the involvement with the mafia that disturbed you and not the need or decision to assassinate a foreign leader.
Correct.
It's a chilling thought, made more chilling by the assassination of John Kennedy. The accusations linger. In some minds, the suspicions persist of a dark, unsolved conspiracy behind his murder. You can dismiss them, as many of us do, but knowing now what our secret government planned for Castro, the possibility remains. Once we decide that anything goes, anything can come home to haunt us. Vietnam, 1968. American soldiers are fighting and dying in the jungles of Southeast Asia. But the Vietnam War didn't start this way. It started secretly, off the books, like so many of these ventures that have ended disastrously. The CIA got there early, soon after the Vietnamese won their independence from the French in 1954. Eisenhower warned that the nations of Southeast Asia would fall like dominoes if the communists led by Ho Chi Minh took over all Vietnam. To hold the line, we installed in Saigon a puppet regime under Ngo Dinh Diem. American-trained commandos were used to sabotage bus and rail lines and contaminate North Vietnam's oil supply. President Kennedy sent the Green Berets to Vietnam and turned to full-scale counterinsurgency. He had once said Vietnam was the ultimate test of our will to stem the tide of world communism. By the time of his death, there were 15,000 Americans there. They were called advisors. The secret war was leading only to deeper involvement and more deception.
It is my duty to the American people to report that renewed hostile actions against United States ships on the high seas in the Gulf of Tonkin have today required me to order the military forces of the United States to take action in reply.
This president was not telling the truth either. The action in the Gulf of Tonkin was not unprovoked. South Vietnam had been conducting secret raids in the area against the North, and the American destroyer, ordered into the battle zone, had advance warning it could be attacked. But Johnson seized the incident to stampede Congress into passing the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. He then used it as a blank check for the massive buildup of American forces. April 1965, two battalions of Marines land in South Vietnam, the first of more than 2.5 million Americans to fight there with no congressional declaration of war. The dirty little war that began in secret is reaching full roar. Free fire zones, defoliation, the massacre at My Lai, napalm, and the CIA's Operation Phoenix to round up, torture, and kill suspected Viet Cong.
We were murdering these people, incinerating them.
Ralph McGee was there for the CIA and helped set up South Vietnam's secret police.
My efforts had resulted in the deaths of many people. And I just, for me, it was a period when I consider myself nearly insane. I just couldn't reconcile what I had been and what I was at the time becoming.
Many of the secret warriors in Southeast Asia had no such doubts or regrets. Some of the team that later joined the Iran-Contra Enterprise helped to run the secret war in Laos.
Coming in from an altitude of about 2,000 feet.
As General Richard Secord later put it, Laos belonged to the CIA. Looking back, it's stunning how easily the Cold War enticed us into surrendering popular control of government to the national security state. We've never come closer to bestowing absolute authority on the president. Setting up White House groups that secretly decide to fight dirty little wars is a direct assumption of the war powers expressly forbidden by the Constitution. Not since December 1941 has Congress declared war. Since then, we've had a police action in Korea, advisors in Vietnam, covert operations in Central America, peacekeeping in Lebanon, and low-intensity conflicts going on right now from Angola to Cambodia. We've turned the war powers of the United States over to where we're never really sure who, or what they're doing, or what it costs, or who is paying for it. The one thing we are sure of is that this largely secret global war, carried on with less and less accountability to democratic institutions, has become a way of life. And now we're faced with a question brand new in our history. Can we have the permanent warfare state and democracy too?
A shellfish toxin.
In 1975, as the war in Vietnam came to an end, Congress took its first public look at the secret government. Senator Frank Church chaired the select committee to study government operations. The hearings opened the books on a string of lethal activities, from the use of electric pistols and poison pellets to mafia connections and drug experiments. And they gave us a detailed account of assassination plots against foreign leaders and the overthrowing of sovereign governments.
Yes, it does.
We learned, for example, how the Nixon administration had waged a covert war against the government of Chile's president, Salvador Allende, who was ultimately overthrown by a military coup and assassinated.
Like Caesar peering into the colonies from distant Rome, Nixon said the choice of government by the Chileans was unacceptable to the president of the United States. The attitude in the White House seemed to be, if in the wake of Vietnam I can no longer send in the Marines, then I will send in the CIA.
This remains for me the heart of the matter. The men who wrote our Constitution, our basic book of rules, were concerned that power be held accountable. No party of government and no person in government, not even the president, was to pick or choose among the laws to be obeyed. But how does one branch of government blow the whistle on another? Or how do the people cry foul when their liberties are imperiled if public officials can break the rules, lie to us about it, and then wave the wand of national security to silence us? Can it happen again? You bet it can. The apparatus of secret power remains intact in a huge White House staff operating in the sanctuary of presidential privilege. George Bush has already told the National Security Council to take more responsibility for foreign policy, which can, of course, be exercised beyond public scrutiny.
And a lot of people in Washington are calling for more secrecy, not less, including more covert actions. This is a system easily corrupted as the public grows indifferent again and the press is seduced or distracted. So one day, sadly, we're likely to discover once again that while freedom does have enemies in the world, it can also be undermined here at home, in the dark, by those posing as its friends. I'm Bill Moyers. Good night.
I've been waiting for something to happen.
What you saw in the Iran-Contra hearings was the exposure of the beginnings of a national security state which believes it has the right to override the Constitution of the United States in the name of security.
I think that there was a substantial shadow government trying to run foreign affairs for the United States.
In any other country, it would have been called a coup. And they seem to have gotten away with it.
These are modern-day pirates, these guys. They have escaped, essentially, the control of national governments, but they're available for use by national governments. Sometimes they move under color of, and defend themselves as advancing U.S. national interests in this. But I think that's very secondary with these guys. They're out to make a buck.
I did do it. I am not, as I said in my statement, at all ashamed of any of the things that I did. I was given a mission, and I tried to carry it out.
The Iran-Contra hearings, convened in May 1987 by a special joint committee of the United States Congress to investigate the sale of U.S. weapons to Iran and the illegal diversion of money to the Contras. Often, the official explanation seemed inadequate and contradictory.
Our government has a firm policy not to capitulate to terrorist demands, that no concessions policy remains in force, in spite of the wildly speculative and false stories about arms for hostages and alleged ransom payments. We did not, repeat, did not trade weapons or anything else for hostages, nor will we.
Despite Reagan's denials, investigations soon revealed that arms had been traded for hostages held in the Mideast.
A few months ago, I told the American people I did not trade arms for hostages. My heart and my best intentions still tell me that's true, but the facts and the evidence tell me it is not.
Only days later, it was further revealed that the arms to Iran had been severely marked up. Some of the profits had been illegally diverted to support the Contras, a guerrilla force organized by the CIA fighting the Nicaraguan government. The Reagan administration had a major scandal on its hands. The use of U.S. government money for supporting the overthrow of the Nicaraguan government was specifically prohibited when Congress enacted the Boland Amendment in 1984. Even though it remained in effect until 1986, millions of dollars in profits from Iranian arms sales were secretly diverted to the Contras during this period through contacts with middlemen such as Moniker Gobanifar. Did these hearings uncover the full story behind the Contragate scandal? Or was it merely an attempt to keep the real truth hidden from public view? Peter Dale Scott, professor at the University of California at Berkeley, has conducted extensive research on covert action and CIA activities. The results are detailed in his book, The Iran-Contra Connection.
I think the real issue was that both the administration and the majority of the people in the committees were frightened that the real scandals, the drug scandals, for example, would really threaten any future conduct of covert operations on the scale that they had been handled in the past. And so they were trying very deliberately to limit the damage. This was damage control.
And so they were pulling their punches on all the major questions and issues of what really happened in this thing, what the CIA's role was. Anytime they got into anything that was really sensitive about exactly that, exactly what the CIA's role was and exactly what laws were broken and when, they went into secret session.
There was a lot of talk during the hearings about covert operations, national security, the necessity of secrecy in conducting foreign policy. But some experts claim that covert action does not work in the interest of the U.S. national security, nor does it create a more stable world.
To think of the democratic governments that have been overthrown in the last 30 years by military coups is almost like giving a capsule history of CIA covert operations in the last 30 years. I mean, there was the overthrow of Prime Minister Mossadegh in Iran in 1953. There was the overthrow of Arbenz in Guatemala in 1954. There was the overthrow of the Brazilian government in 1964. There was the overthrow of the Ghana government in 1966. A lot of the governments I've just mentioned got into trouble with the international oil companies because they tried to assert their national prerogatives over their own resources. Time after time, the CIA has come in on behalf of those multinational companies.
Start a huge covert war that you intend is going to be secret. It's not secret from the Russians. It's certainly not secret from the Laotians who are getting shot at, or the Angolans or the Nicaraguans or whoever it is. It's covert from the American taxpayer and voter. And a lot of people make a lot of money off of it. And it attracts criminals. And it has every single time.
Who are the names, the faces, behind these covert activities? Some, like Oliver North, General Secord, Albert Hakim, are practically household names. But Daniel Sheehan, chief legal counsel for the Christic Institute, a public interest law firm, believes there are other influential players involved.
There exists, in operation now, a secret team of some two dozen men, former Central Intelligence Agency covert operatives, former U.S. Pentagon arms suppliers who have joined together in a private enterprise outside of the control of the American government, either the Congress or the President, who are mounting their personal wars around the world.
Whether there is actually an organized secret team or simply a loose association of individuals, it is clear that there are a number of people who have been working actively behind the scenes in these covert operations. Some of the names are Theodore Shackley, who was Assistant Deputy Director of Operations for the Central Intelligence Agency as of 1976, under George Bush, who was CIA Director at the time. Thomas Kleins, who worked as a case officer under Shackley in Miami and in Laos. General John Singlaub, who worked with Shackley and Kleins in Vietnam and was in charge of the CIA's special operations over the border into Laos. General Richard Secord, who supervised the air operations into Laos and was later assigned to the Pentagon, where he was put in charge of arms sales to Iran. Albert Hakim, who was a salesman for U.S. weapons companies and a middleman in the Iran-Contra affair.
These are the men who have been stirring the pot around the world to instigate these wars on the side of the right wing. And that's the group that we're dealing with right here. We're making war around the world for their own personal profit.
Cuban revolutionary troops such as these have invaded Castro's leftist island fortress. reportedly rallied by a mysterious coded radio message. Alert! Alert!
It was after the failed invasion of Cuba at the Bay of Pigs in 1961 that Theodore Shackley, as CIA station chief in Miami, and his assistant Thomas Kleins, began working with Rafael Quintero and other right-wing Cubans to overthrow the Castro government. In 1965, Shackley and Kleins were transferred to Laos, where Shackley became CIA station chief, Kleins his assistant once again. It was here in Southeast Asia that they teamed up with General Secord and Singlau.
And they there began running the secret war in Laos and Cambodia and Thailand. Everybody in the United States basically thought the war was going on in Vietnam. In fact, it was a major dirty war, covert war. It was fought primarily through assassinations of people that were suspected sympathizers of the Path at Lao, or other people who were not terribly sympathetic to the Western powers.
When Theodore Shackley was promoted to director of CIA Western Hemisphere Operations, he supervised the plans to overthrow the democratically elected president of Chile, Salvador Allende. Allende, a socialist, had promised to nationalize the copper mines and other industries and posed a threat to U.S. business interests in Chile. After a bloody coup, Allende was replaced by a right-wing military dictator, Augusto Pinochet, whose security forces brutally murdered and tortured thousands of political dissidents. Shackley moved on, returning to Southeast Asia.
By that time, the writing was on the wall. The United States was going to be pushed out of Southeast Asia. It was clear that the Viet Cong were going to prevail under Ho Chi Minh. And so what these men began to do, they began to pilfer hundreds of tons of ammunition and military equipment out of Vietnam. They began to construct a covert war capacity that was unknown to the United States Congress, that didn't require supervision by the president, but would pursue the mission that they viewed as their ultimate mission. And that is just to attempt to vanquish any people who didn't support United States foreign policy and who were socialist or communist anywhere in the world.
As private businessmen and government operatives, Shackley, Kleins, and Secord, along with Wilson and middleman Albert Hakim, turned their attention to the Mideast. They supplied arms to Mideast governments while skimming off huge profits into hidden bank accounts around the world. They secretly supplied weapons and military intelligence to Nicaraguan dictator Anastasio Somoza and helped the Shah of Iran eliminate his enemies.
There is an early bond between Iran and Nicaragua. The bond is this secret team of men. So throughout that period from October of 1977 to December of 1978, this secret team has two major operations, one to support the Shah, the other to support the right-wing dictator Anastasio Somoza in Nicaragua. This was their world at that time. The Shah collapses in December of 78, and Anastasio Somoza collapses in July of 1979.
After the overthrow of Somoza, many of his former National Guardsmen fled to Honduras, where they were organized and trained by the CIA as a counter-revolutionary force to fight against the new government in Nicaragua.
They began to create the Contras, to try to do the identical thing that was done by the supporters of Batista against the Cuban revolutionary government back in 1959. Not an indigenous force inside Nicaragua that had any support from any of the population in Nicaragua. It was a total artifice that was created by these men.
One of the original Contra political leaders was Edgar Chamorro. He joined the Contras in 1981.
I became involved with the Contras because the CIA, using people from the White House, they invited me to be one of the Contra leaders. I was told that this was just a war for a year, that the United States wanted to put this pressure on Nicaragua. But then after a year or so, I found out that this was not the case. We were being used to deceive the American people. We were used to lie to Congress. the tactics used by the Contras were tactics of terrorizing civilians, making situations where civilians were getting killed.
Nicaragua, under President Reagan, they are in fact giving the Contras written instructions in violence and destabilization. The target is the people. The social and economic infrastructure is what you're hitting at. It's not a bloodbath. It's like you go into a village and you kill a few people to make your point. The purpose is to disseminate terror. Traumatize the people. We're not killing Sandinistas in the capital. We're not blowing up their homes and terrorizing them. We're hitting at the people throughout the interior of the country.
In the early 1980s, when the CIA was working to establish a southern front in Costa Rica in the war against Nicaragua, a relationship was established with John Hull, an American rancher living in Costa Rica. There is mounting evidence that the airstrips on Hull's ranch became not only a delivery point for illegal Contra weapon shipments from the U.S., but were also used for transporting cocaine into the United States.
You have CIA bases in Costa Rica and Honduras. You have airplanes flying back and forth continuously, landing at bases in the United States, where they don't have to go through regular customs, with the CIA escorting the people in and out in a certain laissez-faire in the attitude at best of the customs, if there is, you know, any customs representation there. So it's a dream situation for drug smugglers.
But CIA involvement in the drug business did not start in Central America. It dates back at least as far as the Vietnam War.
Well, the three men, Shackley and Singlaub and Secord, were all working together from different countries on the huge CIA secret war in Laos. Our allies were the opium-growing tribesmen, and this meant that we continued in a very large way not only to support but really to augment a flow of heroin. This had to be run with the knowledge and the approval of the people who were in charge of these air operations. And these air operations had been controlled in the 66-68 period by General Secord.
The weapons trade and the narcotics trade in the world are two of the top five major money-making transactions in the whole world. These two major commodities in the world are hundreds of billions of dollars that go on. So the amount of money that we're talking about here is absolutely gargantuan. And all that the intelligence community, these guys have brought outside the governmental structures, are tapping into hundreds of millions, which they need to run their operations.
Do you think the Iran-Contra scandal will have an effect on future government operations?
No, I think it would be more of the same.
I don't think that it's going to have much of an effect at all. I just think that they'll be more careful next time.
They will continue to carry on covert operations. I think this has been going on forever.
They make laws which are for us that they don't seem to be able to, they don't apply them to themselves very often.
And who is going to inhibit them? The gangsters that are running this country is going to inhibit somebody.
What's happening here, my friends, is a major deception, which is in process as we stand and talk tonight. A major deception in the same way that the Warren Commission was a major deception worked upon the American people. The same way that the Watergate investigation was a major deception worked upon the American people. Just like the bombing, the secret bombing of Cambodia was kept secret and was a deception worked upon the American people. How long are we going to stand for being deceived in this manner?
Assassination, drug smuggling. If they had pursued that line of questioning, they would have soon gotten themselves into a position where they would have had to impeach someone. they could track that right back into the White House. They could put it at least right under the nose of Ronald Reagan.
This is the major constitutional crisis since the Civil War. You have a president who is unaccountable and says that it's his interpretation of what laws he'll select to obey. When you have that, you have a constitutional crisis.
Covert operations have never done this country any good. They may be of momentary advantage to the people who are in power at a particular moment, but in terms of the interests of this country as a whole, they have proven disastrous. There isn't a single one in 30 years that you can point to and say, well, that was one that we are now more secure, better off, and happier as a result of. Every one of them has in its own way contributed to the deterioration of security in the world that we live in. And so it's really time to stop them.
Instead of operating within rules and law, we have been supplying lethal weapons to terrorist nations, trading arms for hostages, involving the U.S. government in military activities in direct contravention of the law, diverting public funds into private pockets and secret unofficial activities, selling access to the president for thousands of dollars, dispensing cash and foreign money orders out of a White House safe, accepting gifts and falsifying papers to cover it up, altering and shredding national security documents, lying to the Congress. Now, I believe that the American people understand that democracy cannot survive that kind of abuse.
There was a time when ignorance made our innocence strong.
In the late afternoon of December 4th, 1980, an unmarked grave was found in a field in El Salvador. When it was opened in the presence of the U.S. ambassador, it revealed the bodies of four women. Mary Knoll's sisters Maura Clark and Edith Ford, Ursuline's sister Dorothy Kazel, and lay missionary Jean Donovan. Of the five officers later found responsible for the rape and murder of these women, three were graduates of the United States Army School of the Americas. The School of the Americas originated in 1946 in Panama. Now it is located on the grounds of Fort Benning, Georgia. The school teaches commando operations, sniper training, how to fire an M16, and psychological warfare. Since no major declared war between Latin American countries has occurred in decades, and the communist threat has vanished, why provide this kind of training? Representative Joseph Kennedy.
If you look at the course ranges that are offered to these individuals, they in fact are a dedicated way of teaching military leaders in foreign nations how to subvert their local communities.
Since it opened, over 55,000 military officials from 23 Latin American and Caribbean countries have trained at the school, about 2,000 students a year. As facts have emerged about the school and its graduates, it has drawn the attention of a growing number of human rights activists, such as Mary Knoll Father Roy Bourgeois.
Just down the road here is this school, the School of the Americas. It's a combat school. Most of the courses revolve around what they call counterinsurgency warfare. Who are the insurgents? We have to ask that question. They are the poor. They are the people in Latin America who call for reform. They are the landless peasants who are hungry. They are health care workers, human rights advocates, labor organizers. They become the insurgents. They are seen as el enemigo, the enemy. And they are those who become the targets of those who learn their lessons at the School of the Americas.
What has been learned about the lessons taught at the school? In the 1980s, the civil war in El Salvador became a focal point for human rights activists throughout the world. Death squads operated freely, often killing 50 people a night. There were so many cases that on March 23, 1980, Archbishop Oscar Romero in San Salvador made a plea to the military leaders of his country.
I would like to make an appeal in a special way to the men of the army. In the name of God, in the name of the suffering people whose laments rise to the heaven each day more tumultuous, I beg you, I ask you, I order you, in the name of God, stop the repression.
While celebrating Mass the next day, Archbishop Romero was assassinated. A number of years later, the National Security Archives in Washington, D.C. made an important discovery when they obtained a copy of a declassified cable. Cape Doyle.
These two cables are both from the American Embassy in El Salvador. One is from Dean Hinton, who was then ambassador to El Salvador in 1981. And it discusses a meeting during which Roberto d'Aubuisson plans the murder of Archbishop Romero. During the meeting, there is described a lottery that the people who are attending the meeting hold to see who would draw the right to kill Romero himself.
D'Aubuisson was trained at the School of the Americas. Also trained at the school were two of the three officers directly responsible for the assassination. December 11th, 1981, El Mozote, a small village in El Salvador.
First, they forced everyone out of their houses and made us all lie face down in the street, both men and women. There were soldiers on both sides. Then they moved away to see the women kneeling down on the ground to pray. They killed all of them. Not a single one of them survived. Just me, by the grace of God. I hid under a tree. When I heard the screams of the children, and I knew which ones were mine, they were crying, "Mommy, they're killing us."
Over 900 men, women, and children were massacred. Virtually the entire population of the village and the area surrounding El Mozote. Out of 143 bodies identified in the laboratory, 131 were of children under the age of 12, including three infants under the age of 3 months. 10 of the 12 officers cited as responsible for the El Mozote massacre were graduates of the School of the Americas. They were members of the Atlacatl Battalion, a part of the El Salvador Army. November 16, 1989, San Salvador. Six Jesuit priests, their housekeeper, and her 15-year-old daughter were slaughtered. To get the facts about this incident, a U.S. congressional investigation began, led by Representative Joseph Moakley.
I went down, talked with the embassy, talked with the military, talked with the unionists. The killing was done by the Atlacatl Battalion, which is the crack battalion in that country. And these are the people, some of them had just returned from the United States, where they were taught a course on human rights, amongst other things.
19 of the 26 officers implicated in the Jesuit murders were graduates of the school. The United Nations Truth Commission report, released on March 15, 1993, cited specific officers for committing atrocities during the El Salvador Civil War. At School of the Americas Watch, just outside Fort Benning, Georgia, Vicki Immerman matched the names cited in the UN report with names in a United States government document.
what I did was I took these officers, all the officers listed in the report, and I took their names and looked them up in this list of graduates of the School of the Americas, which we received through the Freedom of Information Act. What I found were 49 of the 60-some officers listed were graduates of the School of the Americas.
El Salvador is only part of the school's story. In the entry area of one of its main buildings are photographs of those the school honors, its so-called Hall of Fame. At the top of the list, Hugo Banzer, former dictator of Bolivia, a graduate of the school. Some of the others similarly honored are the former dictators of Honduras, Ecuador, and Argentina, and generals from 8 other Latin and Caribbean nations, many cited by human rights groups for involvement in human rights abuses in their own countries. Among other graduates, Manuel Noriega, former president of Panama, currently in prison in the United States. 4 of the 5 ranking Honduran officers who organized death squads in the 1980s as part of Battalion 316 are graduates. Half of the 250 Colombian officers cited for human rights abuses attended the school. The 3 highest ranking Peruvian officers convicted in February 1994 of murdering 9 university students and a professor were all graduates. During the dictatorship of the Somoza family, over 4,000 National Guard troops graduated from the school. Many of them later became known as the Contras, responsible for the deaths of thousands of Nicaraguan peasants in the 1980s. The general in charge of Argentina's so-called Dirty War was a school graduate. During that internal conflict in the late 1970s and early 1980s, an estimated 30,000 people were tortured, disappeared, and murdered. General Hector Gramajo of Guatemala was the featured speaker at the school's graduation ceremonies in 1991. Human rights groups claim he is the architect of strategies that legalized military atrocities in Guatemala, resulting in the death of over 200,000 men, women, and children.
As a Catholic priest, as a U.S. citizen, I really feel a responsibility to speak out against that because of this. This does not lead to healing. It leads to death and suffering. In a way, this is a death machine. And this, I want to say, is very close to home because it's in our backyard. It's not out there in El Salvador. This is not in South Africa. We're talking about a school of assassins right here in our backyard, being supported and financed through our tax money. It's being done in our name.
An amendment offered
on September 30th, 1993, the School of the Americas was debated by Congress for the first time in its history. It happened when an amendment to the Defense Department budget was introduced by Congressman Joseph Kennedy.
Mr. Speaker, my amendment would reduce the Army operation and maintenance account by $2.9 million. The amount dedicated to running the Army School of the Americas at Fort Benning, Georgia. The intent of this amendment is to close the school.
We're only 30 or 40 votes short of winning. That means that if people around the country hear about this and write their congressmen, we can win. This is an issue that we can win on.
And what's very important right now, I feel, is to let our voices be heard. Bishop Romero said it best. Before he was killed, before he was assassinated by someone who trained at the School of the Americas, he said, we who have a voice, we have to speak for the voiceless. And I realize that we here in this country, we have a voice. We can speak without having to worry about being disappeared or tortured or being picked up. We can speak. And I just hope that we can speak clearly and boldly on this issue.
I'm not very educated, but in my simple words, I think that the only thing the School of the Americas has accomplished is the destruction of our countries in Latin America. Don't give us any more of that military aid. It would be better to help the poor who are in need.
We need the voices of others, and we also need those letters to congressional leaders to let them know that we will not allow them to use our money to run a school of assassins.
For this child. Mm-hmm. He complained from prolonged fever and this wasting.
We have heard that 500,000 children have died. I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. And you know, is the price worth it?
I think this is a very hard choice. But the price, we think the price is worth it.
Worth it because she believes the sanctions are working.
In November 1997, former U.S. Attorney General Ramsey Clark headed a delegation of the International Action Center on his seventh trip to Iraq to investigate the continued effects of the United Nations sanctions on the population. We were shocked by what we saw, an almost total absence of medicines, medical supplies, and spare parts for the equipment. Despite the heroic efforts of medical personnel, babies, children, and the chronically ill continued to die in vast numbers. The United States government claims that Saddam Hussein is to blame for the crisis. What is the real cause of the suffering? The sanctions. They are an extension of the 1991 United States war against Iraq. The goal was to cripple Iraq's infrastructure and make civilian life unsustainable.
We demonstrated the capacity of technology to cripple a country without ever setting foot on it in the Persian Gulf. It's important to recognize that because it goes hand in hand with the sanctions. When we merely say that we flew 110,000 aerial sorties in 42 days, one every 30 seconds on the average, 24 hours a day, we ignore what we really did.
As officials said, the death toll was now 288, with many more to come. The trucks kept filling up and driving away past waiting relatives who knew they might never be able to identify the bodies of their loved ones. The community of Amaria filled one of the first of many funerals with gunfire in sign of grief and fury, and with angry words aimed through foreign journalists. "My mother, she's gone," shouted this young man. This woman asked, "Could not all your modern technology tell you that there were children and women here?" Bill Blakemore, ABC News, in the Amaria district of Baghdad.
We destroyed every silo for grain or anything else storing food in the whole country. We destroyed all the storage and processing of food plants throughout the country. Even dates, the world's biggest exporter of dates. Famous processing and packaging plants in Baghdad, deliberately destroyed. We didn't want them to be able to feed themselves for a long, long time. We're all aware of the famous little powdered milk plant.
The United States government says that in this factory here you are making chemical weapons. Is that true?
No, that's not true.
They are lie, because this is milk for children. Uh-huh. It's powder, milk of children.
Uh-huh. Nothing else was made, only this in the factory?
Yes, and you can see in yourself.
With the only factory in the Middle East to produce powdered milk, they were producing about 17% of their powdered milk requirements. We destroyed that, cut off all the milk, and malnutrition of the mothers immediately jeopardized all of the infants. 70% of the pregnant women, even today in Iraq, suffer anemia.
The death rate for children has soared compared to 1989, the last year before sanctions. One of the biggest causes of death in Iraqi children today is diarrhea and dysentery due to the untreated drinking water. Iraq's water purification plants were heavily bombed in the war, and many that were repaired have broken down. The United Nations bans the import of spare parts and chlorine into Iraq to purify water. We saw the effects of this policy in the hospitals.
This is the second attack form of acute bloody diarrhea, anemic dysentery. Most of them are due to contamination of water. He's malnourished, anemic, underweight with a developmental delay.
Diarrhea and vomiting.
Do you have tap water there?
No.
You see, the conditions of these children shouldn't happen anywhere, and it's caused by the sanctions the United States government insists upon.
The U.S. military used 800 tons of depleted uranium weapons in the war, causing a rise in cancers among the population. Why does the United States government spend $50 billion a year to patrol the Persian Gulf and keep Iraq locked down?
Please raise their hand.
Why does it pressure the Security Council to maintain the total blockade? We need to look back on the recent history of Iraq. For many years, U.S., British, and French oil companies owned 95% of Iraq's oil while they maintained a puppet monarchy in power. The people lived lives of extreme poverty. When the Iraqi people carried out a revolution in 1958 against King Faisal II, U.S. and Britain lost their stranglehold. They sent thousands of troops to the Middle East, but it was too late. Iraq had become a sovereign country. Iraq nationalized its oil and used the wealth to develop industry, modern sanitation, education, an excellent healthcare system, electricity, and highways. Iraqi women won new rights. The United States wants to return Iraq to its earlier status as a virtual colony in order to secure its control over the Gulf region's oil, which is two-thirds of the world's petroleum reserves.
Our involvement in the Gulf is not transitory. It predated Saddam Hussein's aggression and will survive it. Long after all our troops come home, there will be a lasting role for the United States in assisting the nations of the Persian Gulf.
There are those that would like to lift the sanctions. I am not among them.
Our main objective is lifting the sanctions, which has been very, very cruel on our people.
Why do you think Americans want to keep the sanctions?
That's their policy.
Why do you think?
Ask them. That's their policy. It's against the will of the international community. It's against the will of many other countries. I think they are making profits from that. But I don't want to make accusations.
Financial profits?
Yes.
Like how?
Who is selling oil instead of Iraq? Iraq had a share in the oil market. That share was stopped by the sanctions. Who is selling that?
Who?
They know very well that Saudi Arabia jumped from 5 million barrels a day to 8 million barrels a day. 3 million barrels, Iraq's share, have been added to the share of Saudi Arabia.
And we would take this to a war front to protect Saudi Arabia's making more money?
No, you are sharing that money. Everybody knows that.
Before the sanctions, Iraq used its $20 billion in annual oil exports to import 70% of the country's food and medicine.
The cutting off of Iraq's oil by the Security Council has caused widespread hunger.
Starvation of civilians as a method of warfare is prohibited by international law. The sanctions are a violation of the Geneva Convention, the United Nations Charter, the Constitution of the World Health Organization, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of the States.
It's not France, it's not Russia, it's the United States which is imposing these sanctions, which are killing their children by the hundreds of thousands. And we believe that the right policy for the United States government is to stop the sanctions, and that the people of this country who are paying, having our tax dollars used to impose hunger and starvation, are not really being spoken for in this current
crisis.
But
the UN has backed these sanctions.
Well, the United Nations for the last 6 or 7 years has become virtually a plaything for U.S. policy, and that's because of U.S. dominance in the aftermath of the collapse of the Soviet Union. That doesn't mean that the people of the Middle East or the people of the world really support U.S. policy.
Today's march that we're beginning now is a procession to commemorate the more than 500,000 children in Iraq who have died from the sanctions policy, a policy that's so linked. The growing hunger here in the U.S. is reflected 1,000 times in the starvation of more than 1 million people who died in Iraq.
I think it's very important that each one of you came out here today and to keep in touch with us and to raise your voice, to show your face, to stand and walk with the Iraqi people. We are thousands of miles away from them. But when I was in Iraq, I felt so desperately. I wanted to call the United States, and I wanted to say, sisters and brothers, organize a demonstration now. Get together, even if it's 25 people, even if it's 10 of us. Show that we are here in the United States, that they have friends here who do not believe in the extermination of the Iraqi people, that they have friends here who say...
The International Action Center has launched a major medical aid campaign to deliver medical supplies to the people of Iraq. Essential medicines and supplies can save the lives of many, many people. We are asking everyone who sees this video to join in making the Medicine for Iraq campaign a success.
Indonesia, you may well know the story about what the military regime has done to East Timor, but by chance, if even one of you doesn't know it, I'll tell it again, because that's really what it's going to take for the situation to change, is that story told from one person to another, from one community to another, until people simply say they're not going to take it anymore. They're not going to let the U.S. government support these kind of regimes that are responsible for some of the worst genocides in the 20th century. Indonesia, under Suharto, the military regime came to power in 65 in an incredible bloodbath. Perhaps 500,000 to 1 million people killed in Indonesia with the support of the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency because of the reporting of one crusading journalist named Kathy Kadane, who went to journalism school simply to write this article. She had met a CIA agent who had been working in Indonesia, and he talked about how the US CIA made up lists of dissidents in Indonesia and gave them over to the military under Suharto as he rose to power. And the military would go out and kill these people as the US CIA would strike their names off the list. And in this way, they killed between 500,000 and 1 million people from 1965 to 1967. That was how the Suharto regime rose to power. In 1975, Indonesian military regime under Suharto, the dictator, and we mustn't confuse the Indonesian people with the Indonesian military. The Indonesian military invaded East Timor. East Timor is a small country about 300 miles north of Australia. It had been occupied by Portugal for more than 400 years. Portugal went through a democratic revolution in 1974. It was disbanding its empire in Africa as well as East Timor. And East Timor was going through a decolonization process. At the end of November 1975, they declared independence. And then on December 7th, 1975, just more than a week later, Indonesia, the fourth largest country in the world, invaded East Timor. But they didn't invade before Suharto sat down with then U.S. President Gerald Ford and Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, who had come to visit Suharto, and got the go-ahead for that invasion. Suharto was concerned that if he launched this clearly offensive invasion, that the U.S. would cut off military sales to Indonesia, because we have a bilateral agreement with Indonesia that their weapons that they use will not be used for offensive purposes. But once assured that that would not happen, Indonesia invaded by land, by air, by sea, East Timor. First went after the capital, Dili, and the thousands of people who lived there, dragging thousands of peoples down to the sea and shooting them into it as their loved ones counted them off. Just before the invasion, there were six journalists who were covering the events leading up to the invasion as the Indonesians came over from West Timor, the military, and then ultimately had their full-scale invasion on December 7th. And there were five journalists in a small town called Balibo, and they lined them up against a house, and they executed them. They cut off their genitals, shoved them in their mouth, and they suffocated to death as they shot them. Indonesia full well knows how serious it is to when word gets out, and so they tried very hard not to let word get out about what was happening. In fact, after the invasion of December 7, 1975, they closed East Timor to the outside world for more than a decade as they killed the Timorese inside, killing more than a third of the population, one of the worst genocides in the late 20th century, proportionally worse than Cambodia. You might wonder why we've heard a lot about Cambodia, but almost nothing about East Timor until recent years. And that's because the U.S. government was official enemy of Pol Pot and Cambodia, and so the President's Secretary of State would constantly speak out against it, and the U.S. press would print what the President and Secretary of State would say. And that was good in terms of Cambodia, because Pol Pot did commit a genocide there. But in the case of Indonesia, Indonesia was an official ally of the United States, and so Ford and then Carter, Reagan, Bush, and then Clinton are not going to speak about the atrocities that Indonesia has committed in East Timor. And because they didn't, and because the U.S. corporate media rarely diverges from the Washington agenda, the U.S. media hardly covered it at all. One report the day after the invasion by Walter Cronkite for 40 seconds announced that Indonesia had invaded East Timor. And then in the corporate press and the broadcast networks, NBC, ABC, CBS, even PBS, there was not a mention of East Timor for the next 17 years.
My daughter did not belong to any group. She had nothing to do with Noriega. She was innocent. She had nothing to do with all of this. And they killed her.
Bomba. Sabrosa.
Mami, esto sí es verdad. Que yo quiero bailar contigo esta Navidad.
Ay, mamita, mami.
Mami, esto sí es verdad. Que yo quiero bailar contigo esta Navidad.
Yo me voy con Luis Ramírez a comer lechón.
On December 19, 1989, while Panamanians were getting ready for the Christmas holidays, the United States was secretly mobilizing 26,000 troops for a midnight attack. The invasion was swift, intense, and merciless. When it was over, thousands lay dead and wounded, and the country was in shambles. Millions of U.S. tax dollars were swallowed up in 3 days of brutal violence. In many ways, the invasion served as a testing ground for the Persian Gulf War 1 year later. It is also an indication of the kinds of intervention the United States may undertake in the years to come. But still, big questions remain. What exactly happened during the invasion of Panama? And why? As the invasion unfolded, Americans stayed glued to their TVs and newspapers for coverage. But how much of the real picture did the media give them?
The performance of the mainstream news media in the coverage of Panama has been just about total collaboration with the administration. Not a critical murmur, not a critical perspective, not a second thought.
The story that the White House was pushing was getting this so-called narco-terrorist in a net. And that was the thrust of all of the coverage. When are we going to get Noriega? Have they let Noriega get away?
By late today, they had taken control of much of the country, but their chief target, General Manuel Noriega, escaped.
Manuel Noriega belongs to that special fraternity of international villains, men like Gaddafi, Idi Amin, and the Ayatollah Khomeini, whom Americans just love to hate.
They focused on Noriega to the exclusion of what was happening to the Panamanian people, to the exclusion of the bodies in the street, to the exclusion of the number dead, to the exclusion of what happened to the women and children in that country during this midnight invasion.
Noriega was head of Panama's military intelligence and had a long-standing relationship with the United States. He had been on the CIA payroll since the 60s. When George Bush became director of the CIA in 1976, under President Ford, he inherited Noriega as a contact. Despite evidence that Noriega was involved in drug trafficking, Bush kept Noriega on the payroll. In fact, he increased Noriega's salary to more than $100,000 a year and eliminated a requirement that intelligence reports on Panama include information on drug trafficking. With support from the CIA, Noriega was able to outmaneuver his rivals, and in August of 1983, he became commander of the Panamanian military. As the Reagan administration expanded its covert war against the Sandinista government in Nicaragua, Noriega became increasingly helpful. Working with the CIA and with Israeli arms dealers, Noriega helped coordinate an arms supply network to provide weapons to Contra bases in northern Costa Rica.
Noriega's involvement in the drug traffic really increased his importance as a source for the CIA and as someone who was able to conduct dirty tricks in the region for the CIA. So it's no accident that the CIA became the most prominent defenders of Noriega against the drug charges, because that's the sort of thing which CIA clients tend to do.
Despite Noriega's collaboration with many U.S. covert operations, he was becoming increasingly uncooperative with U.S. objectives in Central America. In 1984, he angered the Reagan administration by hosting Latin American leaders at the Contadora peace talks. The talks called for an end to U.S. intervention in Central American affairs.
But relations with Panama are under a new cloud tonight because of news reports
Senator
alleging...
Jesse Helms charged today that the military strongman of Panama, Manuel Noriega, is the number one drug trafficker in the Americas.
The Reagan administration now openly called for his removal.
We do want Noriega out of there and a return to a civilian democratic government.
The U.S. now undertook a systematic effort to overthrow Noriega. Economic sanctions were stepped up and additional troops were dispatched to Panama.
The United States tonight declared in effect that Panama's General Manuel Noriega is a threat to this country's national security.
Mr. Noriega, the drug-related dictator of Panama. We want to bring him to justice. We want to get him out and we want to restore democracy to Panama. And
Sabina Virgo, a national labor organizer, was in Panama just weeks before the invasion.
Provocations against the Panamanian people by United States military troops were very frequent in Panama, and they had several results, and in my opinion, probably a couple of different intents. One, I think, was to create an international incident, was to have United States troops just hassle the Panamanian people until an incident resulted. And from that incident, the United States could then say that they were going into Panama for the protection of American life, which is in fact exactly what happened.
On December 20th, U.S. troops invaded Panama. The invasion was codenamed Operation Just Cause. Shortly after midnight, U.S. troops simultaneously attacked 27 targets, many of which were in densely populated areas. One of the primary targets in Panama City was the headquarters of the Panamanian Defense Forces, located in the crowded neighborhood of El Chorillo. U.S. troops shelled the area for 4 hours before moving in and calling for surrender. It soon became clear that the objectives were not limited only to military targets. According to witnesses, many of the surrounding residential neighborhoods were deliberately attacked and destroyed.
They shot at everything that moved, without mercy and without thinking whether they were children or women or people fighting. Instead, everything that moved, they shot.
The North Americans began burning down El Chorrillo at about 6:30 in the morning. They would throw a small device into a house and it would catch on fire. They would burn a house and then move to another and begin the process all over again. They burned from one street to the next. They coordinated the burning through walkie-talkies.
The Pentagon used Panama as a testing ground for newly developed high-tech weapons, such as the stealth fighter, the Apache attack helicopter, and laser-guided missiles.
President Bush wanted to make certain that this was going to be a success. This was going to be his vindication, a denial of the wimp factor in spades. So they sent down a force that wasn't going to encounter any effective resistance, would simply overwhelm the opposition, and the fact that it would cause tremendous peripheral damage, damage to innocent civilians and on a wide scale, was not of concern in the planning.
My God, we were sending in artillery and airstrikes against a very heavily populated urban area. There was absolutely no question that there were going to be immense numbers of civilian casualties.
During the days and weeks following the invasion, the U.S. policy of applying overwhelming deadly force continued. There were many reports of indiscriminate killings and executions of unarmed civilians.
We have eyewitness accounts on the part of a number of Panamanians where soldiers took Panamanians who had been captured after the invasion and executed them on the street.
During the week of the invasion, more than 18,000 people who fled from the areas of attack were forced into temporary detention centers created by the U.S. forces.
They arrested close to 7,000 Panamanian individuals. They arrested almost every trade union leader, the leaders of the nationalist parties, of progressive parties, of left parties in Panama. They arrested people who were cultural leaders. There are still hundreds of Panamanians who remain in jail with no due process, with no formal charges against them.
As a result of the U.S. invasion, an estimated 20,000 Panamanians lost their homes. Hardest hit were residents in the poor neighborhoods of San Miguelito, Colon, Panama Viejo, and El Chorrillo. How many people were killed in Panama, and who were they? These questions may never be answered, because the United States military undertook elaborate efforts to conceal the number of dead, how they died, and the location of their bodies.
What happened in Panama is a hidden horror. Many of the bodies were bulldozed into piles and immolated in the slums where they were collected. Other bodies were left in the garbage chutes of the poor projects in which they died from the shooting, from the artillery, from the machine guns, from the airborne attacks. Others were said to have been pushed into the ocean.
The truth of the matter is that we don't even know how many Panamanians we have killed, but we should have more information on what happened. How many civilians were killed?
The National Human Rights Commission of Panama interviewed hundreds of people in an effort to determine how many had died.
What we have is different testimonies that help us to arrive to the conclusion that for sure there were more than 4,000 people who died.
The U.S. military said 250 civilians were killed. I mean, there isn't a credible source in Panama that believes that's true. Whether it's ambulance drivers, human rights monitors, people, doctors who worked in hospitals, neighbors of bombed out blocks, it's just clearly false. That story would be so easy to tell for any journalist worth his or her salt, but they're not telling it.
When they interviewed people in Panama about what they thought of it, they invariably were interviewing white, middle-class people who could speak English. They didn't really go into the poor neighborhoods where people had been bombed. Did you see one media actually go into the bombed areas and talk to people who had lost a family or lost everything they had in the bombings?
The transport plane.
They focused totally on the invasion as a tactical event. Was it effective? Did it work well? Are we losing many American lives?
While another unit moved in by helicopter,
15 American servicemen have died.
Gertrude Candy Halen from Dixon, Illinois, is the 20th American to die in the fight.
They focused with utter ethnocentrism only on American lives. The only life that was precious, the only life that one could report on, the only life that one could consider as a serious loss was an American life.
In the months following the invasion, Panamanians were shocked to discover the existence of mass graves where hundreds, perhaps thousands, of bodies were hastily dumped into pits and buried by U.S. troops.
To date, there have been 15 mass graves that have been identified throughout Panama. The United States military was directly responsible for the killings of the men, women, and children that are in these mass graves and for their burial. These mass graves exist throughout Panama, and some are believed to be on U.S. military bases, which creates a difficulty in terms of access to these mass graves.
We found many young people, 15, 16, 18 years old. We found people in their 60s and in their 70s. We found people killed by a shot to the back of their heads, dead with their hands tied, dead with casts on their legs or arms.
Although the U.S. media created a perception of support for the invasion within the United States, the invasion was overwhelmingly condemned in the international community.
If you look at any document in international law, any of numerous treaties, it's clear that this invasion was illegal. It's not debatable.
The Panama invasion violates the UN Charter and the OAS Charter, which have specific prohibitions against invasions of a sovereign country and invasions of the territorial integrity of other countries. These prohibitions are very strict and clear under international law. The United States' actions in violation of human rights also violates the Geneva Conventions, which protect civilians from indiscriminate acts of violence as had occurred against civilian victims in Panama.
The four biggest, most important papers in this country all endorsed the rightness of the Panama invasion. That's the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, strong endorsement, the New York Times, and the Wall Street Journal. Every one of them. Now, a little body known as the United Nations had a vote about this. On December 29th, they voted by an overwhelming majority to condemn the invasion as, in their words, a flagrant violation of international law.
The media was so cooperative with the government because the media are owned by the same interests that are being defended in Central America by that government policy. The media are not close to corporate America. They're not favorable to corporate America. They are corporate America. They're an integral part of corporate America.
We are a plutocracy. We ought to face it. A country in which wealth controls. It may be true of all countries, more or less, but it's uniquely true of ours because of our materialism and the concentration of wealth here. Even our democratic processes are hardly that, because money dominates politics, and we know it. And through politics, it dominates government, and it dominates the media. We really need desperately to find new ways to hear independent voices and points of view. It's the only way we're going to find the truth.
The goals of the United States have been to safeguard the lives of Americans, to defend democracy in Panama.
Then President Bush said we had to go to restore democracy in Panama. How in the world do you restore that which has never existed? Panama has never been a democracy since we created Panama for our own purposes in 1903. And all we did was go down to restore American control and dominance in Panama.
The new government installed by the invasion was headed by the U.S.-backed candidates from the aborted national election. Endara, Calderon, and Ford. Hours before the invasion, they were taken to a U.S. military base where they were sworn in as the president and vice presidents.
Of course, he's not going to say that that Panama is occupied. In fact, he might not even call it an invasion. Cousin is kind that were killed or massacred. He lives in the nicer area, in the oligarchical area. And, you know, his interest was protected. He's not running Panama. He's a puppet of the U.S. government. The U.S. government is running Panama. They're running all of the ministries in Panama. He's only abiding by what he's told to do.
The invasion sets the stage for the wars of the 21st century in South America. The 2,000-mile invasion from Washington to Panama City took place primarily with bases from the United States. The essential value of the Southern Command is to get another 2,000 miles of intervention capability, which takes us right into the heart of the Andean coca-producing region, where the wars of the next decade are entirely likely to take place.
Panama is another example of destroying a country to save it. And it's another case of how the United States has exercised a might make right doctrine among the smaller countries of the third world. It has long been U.S. practice to invade these countries, get what we want, and leave the people that live there to kind of rot.
George Bush, may his children be spared what my daughter is being subjected to. My daughter who doesn't want to live, may his generation be spared what our generation is living through. He should ask God for forgiveness for all the damage caused to many families down here.
One year ago, the people of Panama lived in fear under the thumb of a dictator. Today, democracy is restored. Panama is free.
In March 1991, President Guillermo Endara proposed a constitutional amendment that would forever abolish Panama's right to have an army. Later that year, a law was passed by the United States Congress to renegotiate the Panama Canal treaties to ensure continued U.S. military presence in Panama, on the grounds that Panama was no longer capable of defending the canal.
Everyone knows Ramsey Clark. He's a former U.S. Attorney General. He has been a consistent voice for the anti-war movement for three decades. Ramsey has traveled all over the world and has been in Iraq every year since the sanctions were imposed.
If you think it's been a long evening, wait till I get through. But we're going to have to take some long evenings, because this planet is deeply troubled, and the greatest cause of that trouble is our own government. In the speech that Reverend James Lawson referred to, that Martin Luther King made on April the 5th, 1967, the most startling thing that he said at the time, the thing that caused the most anger and hatred to be directed toward him, was this sentence: "The greatest purveyor of violence on earth is my own government." 31 years ago. Why anyone would have been startled is hard to say, because it was an obvious fact. But apparently we need more education in the obvious than we do examination of the obscure and unknown. Last year, U.S. military expenditures, with all the suffering on the planet, all the sickness and hunger and ignorance and pain, the American military budget was $265 billion. The second largest government expenditure for militarism was $48 billion, and that was the Russian Federation. The United States military expenditures exceed those of the top 12 government expenditures on Earth by themselves, and are more than a third of all the military expenditures on the planet. We have a war party in this country, and we've had it all along. And you can call it Democrat for a while, you can call it Republican for a while, but it has been the special economic interests in this society that have governed us from the time that we founded our governments on this continent. And the people have never controlled those governments. We call ourselves the world's greatest democracy. We are absolutely a plutocracy. It's the most obvious thing in the world. Wealth governs this country. And wealth uses military violence to control the rest of the world as best it can. And we're responsible. And we will pay the price for it. If we don't control our violence, if we don't control the effect of the symbol of our glorification of violence on our children and on the rest of the planet, then this human species is going to be the first to destroy itself completely. And that's the road the United States government has put us on. The single most pertinent statement on this issue was by Henry Kissinger. When the Iran-Iraq war began, over a million very young men lost their lives in that war. Henry Kissinger said at the beginning of the war, 8 years of war, "I hope they kill each other." And that was exactly our policy. What could be better? Have them kill each other. Then who has to worry about that region anymore, you know? And don't think that's not exactly our policy. all over the world where there's poor people living today. That's the solution to overpopulation. Call it triage, whatever you want to call it. Let them kill each other. Let them die. And they're dying all over Asia, Africa, and Latin America, where the masses of poor people live. They're expendable there as they are expendable here. As appalling as what we've done and what we've threatened to Iraq. The worst violence that all of our technology could unleash, and then the strangulation of the sanctions. The thing we have to realize is, it's what our government leadership has been doing all along. It's not terribly different than how we addressed the folks that were here to meet the Mayflower standing on the dock, the North American Aboriginal peoples, the Indians, as we call them. A long, steady course of destruction of those peoples. It's not terribly different than what we did to the slaves that were brought over in chains from Africa, those that survived the transit, which wasn't easy. You look in our history books, you don't read about a Philippine-American war. You read the Philippine history books, and they know about a Philippine-American war. We call it the Spanish-American War. We were liberating the Filipinos. We killed more than a million. Now we're bragging about the covert actions we're going to engage in against Iraq. Do you doubt for a minute that they're planning covert actions in half a dozen other places right now? That we'll react to them 5 years after the misery has begun and the people have been devastated? What we have to realize is that if we don't stand up and stop this now, if we can't stop these sanctions in Iraq, and if with them we can't prohibit any further use of sanctions that are designed to impact on the poor, then there are no poor people on the planet that will ever be safe from our government and its future acts. It's imperative that we stop them in Iraq today and that we prohibit them in the future as applied to any people, because it is a weapon of mass destruction. We have to stop military interventions by our government completely. We cannot permit more U.S. military interventions in foreign countries. We have to stop economic interventions. We've got to cancel foreign debt that has enslaved most of the poor countries of the planet. Cancel it. So let's organize through every effort and opportunity we have in our families, in our churches, in our mosques, in our synagogues, and in our schools, and at our jobs, a massive coalition committed to end militarism and economic exploitation by our government. Thank you. God bless.
September 1st, 1987, S. Brian Wilson began a protest at the Concord Naval Weapons Station near Oakland, California. That's one of the places that send out the weapons that have killed or injured tens of thousands of people in Central America. Brian delivered a letter to the base commander telling him that on that day he'd begin using his body to block the trains carrying his weapons. His hope was that if they stopped the train to save one human life, they were not far from understanding they could also stop it from destroying many human lives, each of equal value in Central America. They must have known he meant business. 1 year earlier, with three other veterans, he'd gone without food for 36 days on the steps of the Capitol to persuade Congress to stop the killing in Central America. Brian Wilson, former high school jock, former Air Force security officer in Vietnam, former dairy farmer who'd received a commendation for his work with the traumatized veterans of Vietnam, was run over that day. He'd put himself in the place of the people of Central America, and in doing so, he opened up the deepest truths of human existence. For the life and times of Brian Wilson had turned him into a satyagrahi, a practitioner of the nonviolent resistance to evil. the path taken by Martin Luther King, Mahatma Gandhi, and Archbishop Romero of El Salvador. Brian trusted that even greater than the power of a speeding train is the power of truth and love. He showed a new kind of heroism, the kind that may just bring the world back from the brink of self-destruction. He acted on his faith in the unity and sanctity of all life, and that if one person will speak and act upon this truth, it will open the hearts of many and provide us a way out in this most desperate moment.
5% of the people of the world live in the United States, but we consume 40% of the resources of the world. We have become used to thinking that we have a right to all that we have, no matter what damage we do to the earth or to other people. We have become detached and disconnected from reality. We have become detached from the earth. We have become detached from the feelings and lives of people elsewhere if it interferes with our right to maintain our lifestyle and standard of living. I would submit to you that we're on a course leading to inevitable annihilation. Martin Luther King said, the issue is not between violence and nonviolence, it's between nonviolence and non-existence. The course we're on in the first world is a course of ultimate destruction. Do we want to be part of this course of ultimate destruction, or do we want to be part of hope and affirmation and justice for all people of the earth? And for the earth itself, without which we cannot live. Yes, I'm talking about a nonviolent revolution of consciousness, a consciousness that is able to understand how we're all inextricably connected to each other on this earth and to the earth itself, and that if we violate those fundamental principles, we do so at our own peril. Yes, we can continue to live in this delusion and the denials of reality because it's painful, it's frightening, sometimes it's terrifying. Just as Vietnam vets have understood, it's terrifying to face the truth, especially when you don't have anybody to talk to. How can we continue as a civilization of we the people if we have to do it at the expense of maiming and murder of people all over the world, whether it's in Angola or El Salvador or Guatemala or Nicaragua or Cambodia or Vietnam or South Africa? Are we going to watch this happen again? Do we just go about our business as usual and know that another 5,000 people will be killed in our name? Or do we have to think about a paradigm shift that somehow is able to experience the anguish of the earth and the anguish of the Nicaraguans and the anguish of the El Salvadorans, whose lives are being threatened by our guns and our money, because we have to protect our national security? Well, I hope and I challenge all of you to think, but more importantly to feel in your heart, how you might be able to act in such a way so that the world can live in peace and justice. And I'm liberated. I'm free to stand anywhere, any place, and tell them they cannot continue to kill mothers and fathers and children in my name as a citizen of the United States. So I ask each of you to search your hearts to what your truth is for being a citizen of the earth, promoting justice as a foundation for peace. It's not going to happen magically, and I think it's not going to happen by relying on these political structures and institutions in Washington. I think we're going to have to wage peace in the most extraordinary ways, whether our government wants it or not. And so I simply say that You will know in your heart, I believe, what to do. But I know that without a nonviolent revolution of consciousness, we will not survive as a civilization or as a planet. We are at an extraordinary point in history where we can choose to have peace if we want to pay the price. And what more glorious goal and value do we want than peace for all people? And so I look forward to working together with you all, with we the people, to build a new society. A society that understands that we are not worth more and they are not worth less. And that we will be willing to pay the price and take the risks to wage peace with all fellow and sister human beings.
I feel ever more empowered to wage unconditional peace